Hi, George.
Good morning. That's morning here, Nikita. Yes.
Yeah, it's afternoon in Moscow. We're on different continents right now.
Okay.
Welcome to Meaning of Life. Let me introduce you first and foremost. So you are Georgian. You're kind of an expert scholar in many things Russian. You have a degree from Yale, PhD from Yale, in Slavic languages and literature. You have taught Russian language and literature. You are affiliated with the University of New England, and you are a research fellow for Center of Global Humanity. Now, the reason you're here today is you are one of the few, or maybe the one. When I googled Russian Cosmism on the internet, you are the only English-speaking scholar expert that came up. And that's the reason you're here today, because we want to talk about the Russian Cosmism, which is this peculiar school of thought, school of philosophical thought in the Russian culture. I should also mention, if somebody were to search for Russian Cosmism on Amazon, that will be one book that comes up, and that's your book, which we will link to in the on our site so that people can look it up. So, since not a large part of our audience are Russian speakers who are interested in obscure philosophical ideas, let's try to define what Russian Cosmism is. So, what is Russian Cosmism, and who were these Cosmists? Who were these thinkers?
Well, Russian Cosmism is, as you say, an important line of Russian thought. It's not the only one, maybe not even the dominant one, but it is an important line of Russian thought that runs from the mid-19th century up through the present day. And the emphasis, some of the emphases of Russian cosmism is the insistence, first of all, that we not only philosophically view ourselves, but actually begin to feel that we are in a cosmos, not just residents of a single planet, not just people isolated in a village, a country, or even the single planet, but our home is the entire cosmos. And we can acknowledge this, say that we have accept the Copernican worldview instead of the Ptolemaic worldview, but feeling that is a different matter. We can talk about how intellectually we understand that we are part of a larger system, but actually feeling that and acting on that feeling, acting on that knowledge is what the cosmists insist on to expand our area of consciousness and our area of activity to include exploration of outer space, exploration of the planets, colonization of the planets, and at some point in the very distant future, the possibility of actually living anywhere in the universe, being human, still being human, but being able to live anywhere in the universe. That's part of the cosmist idea. And the person who is central to it and who began this whole conversation is a 19th century thinker, obscure 19th century thinker, Nikolai Fyodorov, who was born the same time as Tolstoy, 1829, and died only in 1903. So he lived and taught through the latter part of the 19th century and developed these ideas, these far-ranging, almost shocking ideas for his time. The idea of that we not only are able to, but we must travel to distant planets and colonize those planets. His reason for it was connected to a single great idea that he had, that everything we do, excuse me, must be connected to a project of restoring life to all the dead, the idea of resurrection.
And so for
And
him,
so not only, yes.
that idea of his was rooted in religious thought, right?
Religious thought, yes, it is, that this is an active version of the Christian idea, of the heart of the Christian idea, that current Christian practice is a commemoration of the resurrection, but a true religion, true Christian religion, ought to be an enactment of the resurrection. We ought to become not only the resurrected, but the resurrectors, that God gave us that job to do. So the exploration of space, of outer space, the moon, distant planets, and so forth, was part of this religious task, which is to go outside Earth to recover the particles, the dispersed particles of ancestral dust. Fyodor believed that ancestral dust scattered throughout the universe, and so that some part, somewhere, some part of our ancestors was still out there. And so we must go out there and retrieve these particles of dust in order to reanimate them. So it is a religious task for Fyodor to go out and explore space. Also to provide living space, living room, for all the resurrectees, all the people who will be resurrected in life. And his project, crazy as it sounded at the time and maybe still, was that all the people who have ever lived should live again, and that it was our task to bring them back to life, that in the world as it is, we all take our lives from our parents and our ancestors. In the world as it ought to be, we should return life to them. So go back and resurrect the recently dead, then with their help, go back and resurrect their parents. And it's a family business going all the way back to Adam and Eve, so that eventually all human beings who ever lived will live again. And so there will be virtual omniscience. That is, all the people who've ever lived will be alive and will be able to find out anything we want to know from them. If you want to find out why the pyramids were built, ask the people who built them, because they'll still be around. So that kind of thing is part of Fyodor's grandiose idea. And so he included ideas that we would now speak of as cloning, as genetic engineering, things like that, in order to reconstruct the human organism so that it can survive out in places that now are not hospitable to human life. So distant planets, places out in space, to reconstruct the organism so it can survive beyond Earth. So all of these things are part of a single great religious, scientific, religious, magical project that is, he believes, that the Russians should be directing, because their experience, their nature, their experience, their intellectual attitude, orientation, all of that has prepared them better than any other people to lead this grand project of resurrecting the dead.
Okay, so there are a lot of things to kind of, unwrap here. So
yeah.
The one thing that is interesting and peculiar is he starts off with, it is a religious task for him. He takes this directly from the Gospels. He says that
yes. You
know, Jesus Christ told his apostles, you should go and heal the sick and resurrect the dead and cleanse the lepers. So that is a direct commandment from God for him. This is the task of humans to restore all of life. At the same time, and it seems he kind of butts heads later on with different thinkers and philosophers who accept that idea, but take it in a more kind of metaphorical or spiritual or not literal sense. What he's talking about, resurrecting the dead by the means of science in a very, very literal sense.
Yes, it's that literalism that marks Fyodor off from everybody else. Dostoevsky read an account of Fyodor's idea early on. He never knew who had come up with the idea, never knew Fyodor's name, but he read an account of it, and he said never had he read anything more logical and literal. That is the idea, once you give Fyodor one step, then everything fits together. Everything leads to eventual resurrection of the dead. So this literalism, this literalistic idea that the resurrection is not going to be some kind of thing in the distant future brought about by mystical means, but it's going to be a practical task for everyday people. That's his unique idea. Nobody else, I think, has ever said that or probably ever would concur entirely with that idea. But it's Fyodorov.
Right, yeah.
And so many of the cosmists, that we call cosmists, took one idea of Fyodorov's or another idea of it, or argued against him, but said this is an amazing start, a great stimulus, and took positions against him or partial, and developed their different lines of thought from this central core of Fyodorov's.
Maybe we should mention some of these people as well, because when I started looking into this topic generally, it was this idea that sold me, in a sense, not that I subscribed to the vision, but I was profoundly intrigued by this whole sphere of thought, because I kind of figured out, it turned out that I found out something about myself. It is when you have the combination of on the one hand, great intellect, great talent, a lot of the thinkers that we label cosmists are, great scientists who have made real contribution to their respective fields, or philosophers who got acknowledged and are still revered for their work outside of any affiliation with this term cosmos, which I also want to ask you how new that term is, and if it is a new thing. But so you have that combined with something that sounds kind of crazy, that sounds difficult to accept. And to me, that works best, because then I can investigate the idea there's kind of like a safeguard. I don't need to accept it in full, because most of the people who were entertaining these ideas, most of the people in the school of thought itself, were not accepting everything. There are parts in each of these, not each, but many of these thinkers had something that, in order to bring up at a dinner table, you need to first distance yourself from it a little bit.
Exactly, yes.
So yes, who are other people in that school of thought, and can you name some of the credentials? Why we're not dismissing them as crackpots right away?
Yes. One of Fyodorov's near contemporaries who was closest to him in ideas in philosophy was Vladimir Solovyov, who was one of the major thinkers in the history of Russian culture and also in world thought. And Solovyov was very close to Fyodorov for a period of about 10 or 15 years. They were working, they both accepted the idea of the resurrection. Solovyov, who learned of Fyodorov through Dostoevsky, a letter to Dostoevsky that Dostoevsky shared with Solovyov. Then later, Solovyov met him at Tolstoy's house. Tolstoy knew Fyodorov as well. Not many people did during Fyodorov's lifetime, but a few very important people did. And so through Tolstoy and Dostoevsky, Solovyov got to know Fyodorov personally and met with him many times. They exchanged letters. And at one point, Solovyov said that he was Fyodorov's pupil, that Fyodorov was his teacher and his comforter, his mentor. So he took some of his own ideas, especially about the resurrection and the need for an active approach to the resurrection, from Fyodorov. so that it's not just something that we wait for, it's something that we go to create. For Solovyov, however, it had to be an entirely religious and spiritual task. Solovyov was revolted, repulsed by the idea of a technological, scientific technological tinkering with the human organism and with the universe, that this is something that we shouldn't be doing, that within religion itself, whether Christianity, Buddhism, or whatever Christian, or whatever religion that you look at, there are already means to attain immortality and even to bring about the resurrection through more personal devotions instead of some large project that everybody has to be enlisted in, some work project. That through working on yourself and creating your own immortal soul, making your own soul immortal, and then that immortal soul will create whatever body may be necessary for different conditions later on, if any body indeed, physical body, is necessary. Mm-hmm. So Solovyov had a different approach entirely, that it was going to be a religious project, and the first steps should be to become vegetarian, to practice fasting, to practice different various devotions that already exist in not only Christianity but in other religions as well. That's the approach. And so a certain group of people who are brought together under the term Cosmism followed the religious side of it, namely Sergei Bulgakov, Pavel Florensky, and even Nicholas Berdyaev. All three of those have been brought into the the discussion of Cosmism. And as you suggested earlier, Cosmism itself is a fairly new, recent term. The people who are listed as Cosmists had no idea that they were part of a school or part of a movement. Each one was just an individual thinker. But academics later on began to see common threads in their thought and they came up with the label Cosmist, mainly to emphasize their orientation toward a larger picture of human activity. And so the term Cosmist first began to be used probably in the 1980s. Svetlana Semyonova. Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, Svetlana Semyonova, who was in Moscow, and her daughter Anastasia Gachova put together conferences that linked Fyodorov and associated thinkers under that rubric of Cosmism.
So this is this is an interesting thing to ponder as well and to pause a little bit on. You know, I was preparing for this. You mentioned in your kind of overview of Russian Cosmism, you mentioned that one thing that unites all of these very diverse thinkers. Some of them were scientists to the core, and some of them were religious people to the core. There are a few threads that tie them together. One of them is this emphasis on active approach to their philosophy. There's this as I usually hear it in like everyday Russian life, people say that there are two eternal Russian questions. One is who's to blame, and the other is what is to be done. And in the, you know, in modern day in Russia, this is, you know, 2016, this is 16 years of Vladimir Putin. This is more than half of my life. And currently there's a lot of who's to blame around and not a lot of what's to be done. And with the Cosmist thought, it's the proportion is the opposite. There's not a whole lot of blame being passed, but a real emphasis on what humankind should be doing with its role in the evolution of life and or spiritual evolution or whatever angle they take. Do you think that that is part of the reason they are, somebody decided to put them under one umbrella? Because the late 80s and the 1990s is a time where Russians are looking for a new identity and for a new way to answer those two questions, who's to blame, especially, 80s and the 90s, both questions are very starkly put in front of the country. The previous yes. formation has fallen apart, somebody needs to be blamed for it, and then something needs to happen after that. Does it seem to you, I only thought about it, like 10 minutes before our call, but do you think there was some sort of, in that search for a new identity, there were two paths, and one to focus on who's to blame and the other on what's to be done, and what we now have is kind of the opposite of what was proposed by these people who came up with the term cosmists? Does that make sense?
I think that's a good suggestion. Yes, I hadn't thought of that myself, that there was a connection between the emergence of the term and the political situation or the cultural situation in Russia at the time, partly because I saw it too, that they were people who had been interested in Fyodorov and in other and in the cosmos, in Berdyaev and others, other thinkers, were now able to read them and to discuss them. Now, I came to Russia first in 1968, and at that time, a lot of people wanted to read. I had brought some books by Berdyaev with me and by others, and people really wanted there was a hunger for that, even early, even before the 1980s. And so Berdyaev especially, Fyodorov, there was some interest in Fyodorov. I started doing research on Fyodorov in Leningrad in 72, I guess it was, 72 or 73, and talking to people about that at that time. So there was some interest already that was bubbling. Then when the Soviet Union collapsed and everything changed, then people were able to publish books that they couldn't have published before during the Soviet period. They were able to discuss publicly, openly, topics that they had not been able to discuss openly in public before. So that's part of it too, that suddenly there was this burst of energy in rediscovering thinkers and writers mm-hmm. who had been buried really for 50 years. So that was part of it as well. But I think your idea is also very true, that the question of whom to blame and what is to be done, those two questions, and especially the what is to be done. Now, in the West, Fyodorov is almost unknown. I'm the only, as you say, I'm the only one who's written about him. I started writing about him a long time ago, just out of sheer intellectual interest. He was a thinker who's had an enormous idea that captivated me, that I thought was interesting, fascinating, even though I was not subscribing to it. But in the West, the idea of somebody, some group of thinkers taking a positive approach to the great problems of intellectual problems and cultural problems of the world, instead of just saying that things are bad and getting worse and worse, here was a group of thinkers looking at ways to address these problems and to look with optimism toward a distant future, because most of the books written about the future in America and in the West at that time were very pessimistic about all the things that we were going to fail at, whether population or energy, all of these things.
You're talking about what, the 1960s, 70s?
60s and 70s, mm-hmm. Yes, a lot of that. And here was a group of thinkers from Russia who were looking at the distant future in a very positive way. Some of, especially Fyodorov and Vernadsky and Bulgakov. So that was an interesting alternative for those of us in the West who were thinking, maybe we're not doomed to try to read some thinkers who were saying this is a way out of the dilemma.
So you mentioned Vernadsky. Can you introduce him? Because he's kind of, if I look more deeply in it, I would see more of a connection between Fyodorov and Vernadsky. But it seems that they, in some sense, in different parts of the spectrum of this cosmic thought, with Vernadsky being Vernadsky is definitely a safe person to bring up at the dinner table. This is a renowned scientist, a biologist, whose ideas fit fairly nicely into the Western context of philosophical thought as well, right? So can you talk a little bit about him and his notions of the biosphere and the noosphere?
Yes. Vernadsky, I think, is one of the most appealing of the cosmos thinkers. To my mind, Sergei Bulgakov and Vernadsky are the two that appeal personally to me more than some of the others. But Vernadsky especially, because while he refused to go to the West with the thinkers and scientists who were exiled, put on the philosopher's ships, and his son, George Vernadsky, had invited him to come west, first to Czechoslovakia and then to Yale. But he stayed in Russia as a Russian patriot, but at the same time, a very international figure, a person who identified not with one country or one people so much as with the whole tradition of science, of Western science. And saw himself in a line of thinkers that would go back to Newton and be one of the major thinkers in the history of Western thought. So I think that Vernadsky was that kind of person. He was so well-rounded. He was also very much interested in what we'd call the humanities today, in literature, languages, all of that, very well read. And at the same time, he was proficient in so many areas of science. He founded a number of different directions in science. He was the originator of certain directions in biology, geochemical biology, and other subjects. So he was at the forefront of two or three new sciences, and at the same time interested in larger pictures of where are we headed as a human race? What can we do? Что делать? And this idea of being able to bring scientific information and knowledge and concern to these eternal questions is what he was able to do. And he was just a model of integrity as well. Mm-hmm. During a very tough times in the Soviet Union, when people were, even very good people, were forced to do bad things to each other, to denounce each other and so forth. He was a model of integrity, and was able to continue doing his scientific work when it was difficult for that to be done. So he's a remarkable figure, both as a man and as a scientist. A very admirable person. So as you say, he's a name that could be brought up at the dinner table very safely, and was nominated for the Nobel Prize and for other many. He won many prizes. He is the one. He lectured at the Sorbonne in Paris, and was probably the inspiration for Teilhard de Chardin in his idea of the noosphere and of the phenomenon of man. So even without trying to take credit for it, he was probably the origin of that idea.
So let's talk about this a little bit. And it seems, is that the link between Fyodorov and Vernadsky? At least, you know, this is how it looked to me when I was reading this. Both seem to emphasize the idea of kinship of all of humanity and all of yes. life to some extent, though in different ways. So Fyodorov had a real problem with people not being able to recognize that we are all one family.
Yes.
But he, and correct me if I'm wrong, he did not have a kind of a idealistic view of nature at all. He saw nature as, you know, where death does rule, where death is the major force, and then humanity was supposed to be, you know, he didn't have the term noosphere, but the role of humanity in and yes. the role of conscious life in the evolution of life on Earth is to save all life from death, and that is almost an attack on nature sometimes in his writings, right?
Fyodorov's, the phrase that he keeps using again and again in his works is, nature is our temporary enemy, but eternal friend.
Okay.
And so what will make nature our temporary enemy, what will make it our eternal friend is human effort. And so we have to tame nature. We have to regulate nature, and we have to direct nature, because nature running wild remains our enemy. But mm-hmm. When it is directed and tamed and turned toward positive ends, toward life, then instead of driving people to death, then that will be our eternal friend. And an image that he used often again and again was the idea of turning our implements of war into implements of salvation by a simple change in orientation from horizontal to vertical. And the figure that he used for this was the idea that in the United States, people were shooting cannons into the air in order to bring rain at time of drought. So instead of shooting cannons at each other, we should raise them so we shoot them at the clouds to bring rain and to create conditions that will enhance life. And that is his idea of our role toward nature, is to redirect our efforts and radically redirect what we are doing so that nature will become our friend instead of our enemy, our temporary enemy. And so I think that idea toward nature, the idea that human intelligence has a role to play in the future of the planet, mm-hmm. and the future of, especially of the planet, in its relation to the solar system and to the rest of space, is part of the idea of the noosphere, that it's human intelligence and reason. Fyodorov just talked about reason all the time, but the idea of the human mind having an important effect in nature, the idea of the noosphere certainly would come out of that.
But there are, so as it seems to me, there are two kind of big differences between the Fyodorov's and Vernadsky's view on this whole business. And one is, for Fyodorov, this is a task that we can fail to address, that we can fail to undertake. And then the second is, yes. It seems that Vernadsky has a much more And then for Vernadsky, this is, you know, he takes this kind of long view. He always talks about geological forces, and he views the human mind, you know, consciousness, reason, as one of the great geological forces that is now coming into power. And so, you know, you just need to, if trying to analyze the situation kind of detached, you just see a new thing appearing and starting to change the world, and there's not really much you can do about it. This is already happening, right?
Yes, that's right. Yes.
And then the other thing is for Fyodorov, so he's talking about this temporary enemy, while Vernadsky has kind of a more holistic maybe view, where the human mind is a part of this larger system, but is not in any way separate from it. And it's just starting to take its part in the larger scheme of things, right?
Yes, exactly right. Exactly right. That there is an important difference between Fyodorov and Vernadsky, and why Vernadsky, I think, is much more appealing, because Fyodorov, to accept Fyodorov's project, his task, would require a reconstruction of the universe and of the human organism, and whether we will ever be capable of, with our limited intellects and abilities, to reconstruct ourselves and reconstruct the universe is a terrible question. I mean, it could point more toward disaster more quickly than toward success, probably. Whereas Vernadsky sees this as a long natural process that has been going on for thousands of years and will continue. And so that idea, that's why I think Vernadsky is more appealing, and in a certain way, in the social sense, why Bulgakov is more appealing as well. Bulgakov, his idea of the philosophy of economy, philosophia khozyaystva, the idea of economy as being responsible ownership of the planet. And so Bulgakov talks about how the world as it is already is okay. And what we need to do is to take better care of it and to bring out the better qualities of it and to sacralize it instead of profane it. And so Bulgakov doesn't require a total remaking of the universe. He says that the universe is already made and created, and we don't need to recreate it. We just need to take better care of it. And that's an appealing idea too, I think, that is more, means more today, I think, than the idea of starting immediately to try to rebuild everything, the whole universe. So I think for me, Bulgakov and Vernadsky are the two great thinkers in the cosmos tradition. And certainly Vernadsky, his writings about a letter that he wrote to his granddaughter about the coming atomic age. And he was, of course, worried about the future of atomic power, but also talked about the potential, the great positive potential of it. So I think that for me, Vernadsky is certainly a great mind, a great figure that took the cosmist direction of thought in a good direction, good further direction, as further advanced it.
Are there any direct ties between Fyodorov and Vernadsky and Bulgakov? So did Vernadsky write or speak about Fyodorov? Do we know if he read him?
He certainly knew about him and knew his idea. I haven't read anything that Vernadsky wrote that comments directly on Fyodorov's ideas. But Vernadsky was in touch with other people who were talking about and writing about Fyodorov, including Florensky. Mm-hmm. Pavel Florensky wrote quite a bit about Fyodorov, and he was also a close correspondent of Vernadsky's.
Can you introduce Florensky as well to the audience?
Florensky was one of the Cosmist thinkers, or Cosmist-related thinkers, who probably deserves the title the Russian Leonardo as much as anybody. He was an early mathematical prodigy. His works in mathematics were important at the time and apparently remain so today as a very young man. Then he, like Solovyov, he changed directions many times. He started and became a genius at mathematics. Then he switched his direction and started studying theology, Orthodox theology. He became an Orthodox priest. He was also an artist, a poet. He was head of a movement, of an early avant-garde movement of Russian art and poetry in the 1920s. He was close friends with all the leading intellectuals of the Russian Silver Age, of the symbolist period in the early 20th century. So he was such a well-rounded person in science, the arts. He was later arrested and sent to Siberia and then to the far north, to the Gulag. And while there, he did scientific experiments. Continued to write scientific papers from the Gulag. Just a remarkable person. There's one episode in his life when he was teaching just after the revolution. He was teaching the young workers and technical communist officials about electricity, how to to spread electricity through Russia at the time, and what needed to be done to electrify Russia. But he was lecturing in his priest's kaftan, in his white priest garb. And so here, standing beside a bust of Lenin, preaching to or teaching the workers, wearing a priest's kaftan.
Not something you're supposed to do.
Not something you're supposed to do. And Trotsky saw him. Trotsky came to this factory where he was teaching and said, "Who is that?" And somebody said, "Oh, that is Professor Florensky." He said, "Ah, yes, Florensky, I know." So he said, "Come to my office," having come to my office. So Florensky came to his office and Trotsky offered him a position teaching at a different level, a higher level, said, "But not in that outfit." Well, Florensky said, "I can't dress in street clothes. This is what I wear." So Trotsky said, "Oh, well, that outfit, okay." So he gave him a job teaching in his priest garb, said, if you have to do it that way, do it. So it's he's an interesting person.
That seems to be also a weird running theme with these Cosmists, because Fedorov also has a bunch of anecdotes where he was a teacher and he was not dressing the way teachers are supposed to dress.
Yes. Oh, yes.
So there's a like going against the expectations, the sort of the polite way of doing things seems to be a running theme with these thinkers as well.
Well, and here was with Florensky, here was a person who had made a reputation in mathematics. He had made a reputation in other sciences and in the arts. But what he is best known for now among many people is his great work of devotion, the pillar of truth, the rock and pillar of truth, that is a series of 12 letters, devotionary letters, that is a classic now of Russian spirituality. So he wrote one of the great works of Russian devotion, spiritual devotion, as well as mathematical papers, papers on electrical work, and everything else. And now one of the Orthodox churches in the U.S. has proposed him as a saint. I don't know if he's canonized yet, but they did propose that Father Pavel be a saint. So quite a person. But many of the people listed under the rubric of Cosmism were very broad. Vernadsky himself was a very broad person, talented in one direction, but also very broad. The same with Bulgakov. He was early. He was known as a socialist. His book as a great future Marxist writer, and he switched to from Marxism to idealism is the title of one of his books, and he became a theologian as well. So many of these people who excelled in one area were nonetheless very competent in several areas.
So let's get back to Vernadsky for a little bit. So we said that one of the things that one of the threads that make these thingers appear under this one umbrella of Russian cosmism is the orientation towards big projects for humanity. And we talked about the radical idea of Fedorov with the resurrection of the dead. Now, Vernadsky had some radical ideas of his own. He did not coin the term biosphere, did he?
No, he did not. He did not coin that term, but he wrote the definitive work about the biosphere.
About the biosphere. And then Teilhard de Chardin developed his idea of the noosphere, and Vernadsky continued that work as well. So there was,
yes,
but there seems to be like not influence between the two.
And Teilhard may have gotten the term from Vernadsky himself during Vernadsky's lectures at the Sorbonne, because Teilhard and his associate attended those lectures. And so there was close relationship between them. It was kind of a collaboration, probably.
Okay. And so Vernadsky, in developing his ideas about the bio and the noosphere, came up with something known as the autotrophic man, right? So he's looking, he's a biologist studying plants, apart from other things, and has a certain reverence toward the plant life in general because of its unique feature to turn sunlight into food for themselves. And so he viewed also kind of a transformation for humankind, that, you know, also an idea pretty large. And he wanted humankind to become like plants in the sense that we would if we dress it up in kind of more manageable terms, the two parts are abandoning oil and coal energy for the sake of solar energy, and then learning how to synthesize food using that. And then, in effect, we become similar to plants in our ability to not eat others, not kill animals, and just use the sunlight as the main source of energy for sustaining ourselves.
Fyodorov had that idea as well. Fyodorov writes that the history of humankind is the history of cannibalism, that we eat our parents, we eat our ancestors, either directly or indirectly, because if we eat a potato, chances are that that potato has traces of our ancestors in it. So literally, we eat our ancestors, and figuratively, we devour their lives to enrich our own lives. So he said that the future of man must be to end this state of cannibalism and to become, to find a way to survive without eating first meat and then other things, eventually become, he didn't use the word autotrophic, but he did talk about that concept. And he didn't know how it might come about. Mm-hmm. But the idea was there as a moral idea that we've got to stop being cannibals and somehow start surviving on in some way other than feeding on our ancestors in every possible way, figuratively and literally. So Vernadsky came up with the scientific explanation or proposal for that moral idea of Fyodorov's. It's kind of interesting there. And Fyodorov said that he didn't know how in the future great scientists would find a way to do these things, mm-hmm. but they would if they took that as their task. And certainly Vernadsky, without mentioning Fyodorov, certainly did find a way to describe that in scientific terms, just as Tsiolkovsky did.
I was just about to bring him up, yeah.
Yeah, same thing.
So let's talk about it. This is the episode with the most incredible density of complicated Russian last names on our side. But let's talk about Tsiolkovsky. So there's a similar dynamic here. Fyodorov did speak already in the 19th century, did speak about space colonization and space flight. But for him, that was a continuation or maybe a subset of his bigger issue with conquering death.
Yes.
Now, Tsiolkovsky was his direct pupil, or was that, would that be the term? Because there's also an emphasis on like self-education in their relationship, right?
His mentor, Fyodorov, was his mentor in the library. Fyodorov was a great librarian, working in the library, and brought books to people who were doing research. And sometimes he would add things for them that they didn't know about that would help them with their research. And Tsiolkovsky came to the Moscow library to for self-education. He wasn't able to afford to go to a school, so he was going to educate himself in the library. And Fyodorov took him under his wing and helped him learn, told him what he should be studying, how to go about it, and basically gave him a tutorial for a couple of years in what he ought to know as a future genius, as a future man. So Tsiolkovsky went back to Kaluga and started working on models for rocket ships and things like that. So it was Tsiolkovsky says that he and Fyodorov never discussed space travel. Mm-hmm. Now, that's interesting. Here were two people in Russia in the 1870s who were interested in it, but never spoke about it, he says. But
probably like the two people who would even take the idea seriously, right?
Yeah, right. So, anyway, Tsiolkovsky did go back to Kaluga and teach. He was a science teacher in a school there, and in his spare time started doing these formulas for artificial satellites and things. So it's just remarkable what he was able to.
Not only he started doing that, he did accomplish that. Was he the first one to actually successfully calculate the necessary equations for?
He was. His calculations were the first, and they were, of course, other people built on them, but these were the first ones. Yes.
So he's generally regarded as sort of the either father or grandfather of the Soviet space program.
This is all happening
in his apartment or something. He doesn't have a proper lab or anything.
No, it's just kind of in a shed near his house that he built. And using wooden models that he crafted himself So yes, he didn't have a proper lab or anything like that. It was all just things that he devised out of his own, out of the wood that was at hand. And this is part of Fyodor's idea too, that you work with what you have, with simple things, that you don't need big equipment or laboratories or anything.
And then Tsiolkovsky also had, I don't know if we should, I guess spiritual would be the term to describe that. He had a dimension to his thought. He would consider himself a panpsychist.
And yes, had panpsychist.
Of something you called atom spirit, right? Can you talk about that? Yes. What is atom spirit?
The idea that there is a spirit, there is life and spiritual life, maybe even a soul inside every particle, every monad in the universe, so that life extends throughout the universe already, and that there is. Life is teeming in the universe, and some of it is at a low level, at a primitive level. Others is much more advanced than we are, in Tsiolkovsky's view. So the whole universe is alive, is part of his idea. And so the idea also is that as we develop, it will be kind of like a universal Darwinism. That is that the fitter will survive and others will fall by the wayside. That is kind of a troubling idea that runs counter to Fyodor's idea that resurrection will be for everybody, mm-hmm. and we can't stop until everybody is in. Tsiolkovsky was much more selective in that way, that the geniuses would prevail, engineers and scientists and geniuses will prevail, and others will kind of fall by the wayside. But
Fedorov would never accept that, right? Fedorov had this whole focus on, this is like, I said that it's his idea of resurrection that got me interested. It's not the idea of resurrection. Resurrection itself is, you know, that's fine. I can read that and continue without, you know, stopping a whole lot. But he has this idea that if on this path towards perfection, towards God, humans achieve immortality and then do not resurrect everybody, every generation that has lived before them, then that's just like morally wrong. Who are you? Who are we? Why would there be one generation that takes the ultimate gift, the supreme good, and does not, you know, pay their due to all of these previous generations that got us here, right?
Yes. That's a function of human maturity, mm-hmm. of humankind's maturity. Right now, we're still in an adolescent stage, but we will mature. And as we mature, then we will turn attention from ourselves and our own immortality to the need for our predecessors, our ancestors, to also live. So it's a question of maturity for Fyodorov. The idea that we're all rotten adolescents now, that society, history, or culture is filled with adolescent values and all of that. So and maturity is what's required. Solovyov believed that too and was even more articulate about it than Fyodorov was. But for Tsiolkovsky, it's a different story. An interesting person, but at the same time, with his scientific genius, a lot of his ideas sound a little bit strange and silly at times. He was very much interested in the movement of theosophy with Madame Blavatsky, mm-hmm. and wrote a lot of pamphlets that sort of fit into her scheme of things, her ideas of the theosophical worldview with all of its kind of strange features as well.
So with his ideas of panpsychism, there was, tell me if I got it right. So he's saying that it starts reasonably enough. He says, since life has emerged from unliving matter, then it means that in all matter there's a potential for life. Under certain conditions, non-living matter yes. becomes living matter, and then that becomes conscious, and then so there's a potential for becoming what we are in basic elements. And then he extends that view further than we are. He says that there also must be creatures or entities or a way of existing that is past human form, and that would be entities with no physical form. So the further you go along this ladder, the less material you become. And then right. it sounds like he's basically talking about angels or something like that, right?
Yes, right. Yeah, some kinds of entities that don't require physical bodies anymore. Yes.
And then he also thinks that they are already in communication with us, and that's how we get already. Our ideas. Is that correct?
Yes, yes. That already they are the guiding forces of the universe, and that they have influenced the development and will continue to influence the development of humanity.
Do we know if he had any personal experience, mystical experience or something? Where does he take this idea that there are unseen entities that guide us from?
I think from theosophy. Mm-hmm. From Madame Blavatsky's world, her philosophy of the masters. There are in theosophy, there are hidden masters living. Well, they live in the Himalayas somewhere, who are eternal. They've been alive for hundreds of years, and they emerge from time to time to speak with living individuals, with us, mm-hmm. People like us. They spoke with her to make communications, to give communications, tell them, to give them advice. So there are the masters that live here in the far Himalayan mountains, in the world, and then there are forces beyond them as well. So this idea of a hierarchy of forces, of intelligences, and I don't know if he wrote anything about the Himalayan masters, but certainly some of his, it's hard to tell what are science fiction and what are some of his serious ideas presented as tracts and pamphlets in some of the little things, brochures that he published.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Some of these are coming out now, I gather. I haven't seen them, but his grandson is publishing a lot of things that I understand that Tsiolkovsky wrote that had never been published before.
That is interesting.
Yeah.
Tsiolkovsky, yeah. Coincidentally, is the name of one of the best Moscow bookstores nowadays.
Oh, it is. Interesting. That is interesting. Yes.
Okay, so we had a pretty good overview. Well, I obviously we haven't mentioned all of the people we should have mentioned, and each of these people and even each single idea of any of them deserve longer time. But can we make a transition to modern context? So it seems that with all of these big ideas, space colonization, achieving immortality, managing nature, there are many parallels between this train of thought and what is in the West nowadays known as transhumanism. Do you see any? Do transhumanists take some of this from Cosmism? Is there a connection between the two, or are these separately evolved schools?
Most of the transhumanists don't know about the Cosmists or are not interested in them, partly because of the Russian background, the Russian cultural qualities of the Cosmists, the religious angle and so forth. They're not interested in that. There's one group in Florida now that is a church. It's called the Church of the Everlasting Life or something like that, and have chosen Fyodorov as their main saint. That's interesting that they are transhumanists, and they advise people who want to achieve immortality, physical immortality, and so they are building a community of immortalists under the name or under the rubric of Fyodorov there in Florida. I don't know how many, they meet once a month, I think, and I don't know how many people are involved or attend their services, but it's a church, it's an active church. The transhumanists that I guess we know more about really don't know much about Russian Cosmism. And I think that their whole direction is the scientific direction, and that immortality for its own sake, the idea that we all want to live forever, but they have never considered the possibility or the need for restoring life to others, to the ancestors before. And so this is something that Fyodorov warned about and that others, Solovyov also warned about, is that if you take only the scientific side, only the technological side, and ignore the whole spiritual dimension, then it will lead to a disaster, to a kind of hell, a technological hell of immaturity. Also, if you take only the spiritual side and ignore any kind of technological side, it will lead only to a kind of an empty paradise, some kind of virtual mental paradise that has no other reality.
Right, there's no physical reality. Direct steps that we're supposed to do now if we take just the spiritual path.
Right, exactly. So one side or the other is insufficient. You need to have a project that is holistic, that is both spiritual and scientific. So the Western transhumanists and various forms of transhumanism, I think, are all technological movements without much of a spiritual dimension. So that's why I've been trying to bring Fyodorov's ideas and the Cosmists' ideas to the attention of more people in English. There's going to be a book that will, I'm doing a chapter for a book that will be coming out in a year or so, that will probably be for university students on a course on the new transhumanist movement. It'll be the first courses, I think, that have been taught on transhumanism in the West. And so I'm doing the chapter on the Russian Cosmists. Other people will be writing about the transhumanists and more recent developments.
That is so there is a kind of an effort to contextualize this hidden train of thought with the larger Western.
Yes.
Okay, that is good. That is a plaudible endeavor. Okay, well, I guess. Sorry, go ahead.
How about in Russia, Nikita? How aware are the Russian transhumanists? I guess they are fully aware of the developments in Western transhumanism as well. But the current Russian transhumanists, are they at all interested in Fyodorov and the earlier Cosmists, or are they of the mind that they have gone far beyond the earlier stages and no longer need them?
I wouldn't be able to speak with any confidence about that. I haven't like researched the transhumanist movement in Russia. I do know some people who would probably be in that camp, and it seems that, at least to me from the outside, it seems that the Russian transhumanist movement is kind of the Western transhumanist movement. There, because you know, these are people who read English. These are people who are in the same sphere of ideas as the Americans or, yes, or British or Europeans, and you know, it's the same people that they are reading. I don't think the Russian cosmists enter the picture a lot, and generally, individual thinkers are known. But this umbrella of the Russian cosmism, people know the term, people have heard the term, but not many people. It's not very visible. I wouldn't say so.
Yes.
In Russia, as I guess, less so than in the West, but still, it's not very prominent. I think that I actually recently saw a few articles about the Russian cosmism, and in the preface to one of these articles, the journalist wrote that the term Russian cosmism came to public's attention in like a couple of years ago, when there was this online magazine called The Russian Planet, that you know, was a solid independent newspaper that, as it happens with solid independent newspapers, got closed and new bosses were put in charge because they went against the political line. And there was a transcript of the conversation between the new bosses and the journalist collective published, and the critique that the bosses gave, that when they asked, why are we all being fired, the new bosses said, well, you lack cosmism. And nobody really knows what they meant by that. It is not yeah, likely that they're referring to the Russian cosmists. They just use that word. And this is how the term Russian cosmism sort of resurfaced on the internet, on social media. And suddenly, you know, people who have like scholars or, you know, people who not specialize in Russian cosmos, but generally, you know, this is a philosophy professor from university such and such, started getting these invitations for an interview for what is the Russian cosmos, because the term appeared somewhere on Twitter and got retweeted a bunch of times.
Interesting.
So yeah, this is it's still pretty obscure, and I still kind of think that, you know, the conclusion that I draw for now is that the appearance of the term Russian cosmism is, in a sense, an attempt to create a cohesive kind of new ideology or frame of thought or perspective for Russians, more than it's like, you know, it's a frame that it has been created for us to view all of these thinkers in a certain way, but it could have been a different frame. It could have been, you could have excluded you could have created a term that would only refer to the spiritual part of this movement, and then some of the people would be left outside the brackets, and or you could do the other thing, and you would have, you know, the transhumanist movement without all of the spiritual sides of the Russian cosmism.
Yes, I think the person who was responsible for putting them all in one basket was Svetlana Semyonova, who died 2 years ago, Christmas time, and her daughter, Anastasia Gacheva, who she's now director of the Fyodor Museum in Moscow. And they have been using the term cosmism since, I guess, the 80s in collections of works that began as works by and about Fyodorov, but were broadened to include other thinkers as well, both scientific and religious. So I think you're right that the idea of trying to create a movement in Russian thought that goes back retrospectively into the 19th century and that continues today is part of the project that the Fyodorov Museum has taken on as its part in the общее дело, in the common task. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that they're publicizing and trying to propagandize, actually, in the best sense of that word, the Cosmist ideas, and to present it as an important Russian national phenomenon, so that a respectable, to make it academically respectable, and to make it something that Russians can be proud of. Mm-hmm. I think that's part also of what Semyonova and Gacheva have been doing is talking about the Cosmos as a great movement that is purely that is Russian and that Russians should be proud of and should consider a flower in their cap, really. So an important contribution to world culture and thought.
Right, and there's also a potential here. Like Russia is, it's often talked about as kind of a national, like country with nationalistic tendencies, which, I mean, it's not difficult to make a case for it, but I think there is, you know, it's a little more complicated than that. But this project has, as one of its virtues, the ability to address that need for a Russian identity and a thing to be proud of as Russians, but also, you know, there's time and time again in writings of different Cosmists, it is emphasized the kinship of all people is emphasized, and yes. You know, it struck me with Vernadsky, you know, point of style probably more than anything, but when he refers to previous to thinkers that he was inspired by or scientific discoveries that are relevant to his work, he, instead of giving the decade or the century or year when this was published, he says this happened two generations ago, and this happened like 40 generations ago. And it gives you a feeling, he's really emphasizing through this, I think, this is a continuous process. This is where it's like our grandfathers have written this, and then great-great-great-great-grandfathers have come up with that. And even when he talks about, you know, the appearance of farming, he still uses 600 generations or something ago this happened. So he has this very long view of human development as a continuation of just evolution of life, and it all goes infinitely back. I think didn't he have an idea which is now not accepted, I think, in science, that no matter how far you look, there's life always comes from life.
Yes, right. Yeah, I think so. That's something that now people have discarded, an idea that has been discarded. But yeah, Vernadsky, what I like about him too is that he underplays the idea of the great individual, and speaks of himself as another in the tradition, you know, as someone else carrying on the great tradition of science, of scientific investigation. And so it's, I think, one in the West, we tend to emphasize the personalities, Einstein this, or you know, the names of various scientists, but for, as you say, for Vernadsky, it's It's more the idea of my grandfather's generation or that generation, two generations ago, the idea of connectedness and of continuity that's important as well, rather than disruption of the continuity. Mm-hmm. So the idea that we are continuing a process that began a long time ago, an intellectual process in this case, just like a geological process. It's something that began long before us and will continue long after us. That sense of where you stand is important, and it's part of the cosmos view, I think, that they all share, is that we are still an immature race of being, that humanity hasn't reached its full potential yet. It hasn't reached the end of its evolution, and so we have to try to shape it toward a positive direction.
That is a beautiful note to end us on. This has been very exciting for me. I enjoyed this conversation a lot, and maybe if you don't mind, we can do this again sometime, and maybe we don't have to wait until that book is coming out about transhumanism.
I'd be happy to. I've certainly enjoyed this as well. It's been a really valuable conversation for me. Your comments and questions have really been brilliant. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you.
Thank you. All right. Well, I'll talk to you later then, hopefully.
Again. Okay.
Thank you.
Till next time. Bye.